Jackson, one of my students about 8 years ago, is now my assistant, working very hard for our program, and he's my arms and my legs today. We also have our annual Santa's Pizza Party, we call it, which is the largest Christmas party. We took care of 794 children last year from the poorest sections of town. We take over the L.A. Lee YMCA, indoors and out. We turn it into a winter wonderland. We have gifts for every child, and what's beautiful is we sit the parents down and the child picks his or hers only, her gift by herself or himself, which we think is a wonderful idea. We have the Love Thy Neighbor eyeglass program at our feedings. We have a noted ophthalmologist, Dr. James Lang, who gives out glasses, measures eyes, and it's a wonderful increase to what we do otherwise. We have our Compassion for Kids program, which of course puts on the Christmas party. And also we take care of children who have autism, who are amputees, who have AIDS. We take care of the children and their families and do the best we can to help them so they can live a normal life. And we have our annual gift bags for the homeless. We spend all year collecting items, toilet items primarily, t-shirts, underwear, washcloths, things that they vitally need. We provide 2,000 blankets every year for the homeless, and we hope to continue that program. And other than that, we don't do much but get in the way of the city of Fort Lauderdale. I am Peck's bad boy to the city. However, I just want you to know that we're not finished. We're not about to stop feeding. Let me get back to where I started. The program says, the book says, Love Thy Neighbor is a voluntary organization embracing the vision and passion of one woman, Maureen Abbott, who devoted her life to caring for as many of the poor, hungry, and homeless as she could reach. With your help, we have helped thousands, but there are still more who need assistance. I want to tell you a little bit more about Maureen. My angel. I lost her in 1991. That too is 25 years ago. And she and I used to feed the homeless. When we were first married, she made extra food every day. And we'd go out after we had our dinner and bring food to as many homeless as we could find. And in one instance, we fed around the main library in Fort Lauderdale. And at one point, I was kind of chasing a gentleman. We had made up bags of food, sandwiches and drinks and snacks. And I was literally chasing people around the library. One gentleman I chased until he stopped two blocks away and said, "Why are you chasing me?" And I said, I was just wondering if you were hungry. I would like to give you a snack. And he said that, I'm sorry, you haven't heard a word I've said, have you? I'm okay. I've got it now, thank you. He said, I was just waiting for a bus to go home. I said, well, would you mind taking this with you? And so we parted friends. But a week later, we were feeding out of Temple Emmanuel on Oakland Park Boulevard, where I was a member, and we've been feeding hot food ever since that day. We feed gourmet meals. We don't just feed food. We take great pains. And it says on the side of our van, at every Love Thy Neighbor meal, the most important ingredient we use is love. We put lots of love. Love is in our name. Love is what we are. Love is what we do. And love of humanity, people loving each other, is what we care about. Love thy neighbor is very important to us. It's our motto. Also, we say, give a hand up, not a hand out. We do what we can to help the homeless. Unlike like what the city of Fort Lauderdale says. By the way, I've renamed the city because of all the man-made canals. They call themselves the Venice of America. I call them the city without a heart. It is harmless to the laws they have passed are unbelievable. Not only that, they're impossible to obey. That's why I disobey them. This is a town when a year ago is when I received a lot of notoriety because that's when they first arrested me for feeding the homeless, that horrible crime. I don't know of any church, any religion that doesn't talk about feeding the poor, taking care of the widows and orphans, leaving the lower branches of your trees for the poor, leaving the fruit on the ground for others to pick up. This is vital. This is paramount to every single religion I've ever heard of. And I am my brother's keeper. Love thy neighbor as thyself for what I live by. And I will continue for the next 20 years, a Jewish lifetime, by the I underestimate, because a Jewish lifetime is 120 years. So I've got almost 30 left. And I hope to be able to continue my work. If anybody has any questions about what we do, and we can always use volunteers, all of you lovely ladies who like to cook. Every Tuesday, we shop all morning. We go to Pompano, to Restaurant Depot. Then we go to Feeding South Florida in Hallandale. And then from 1 o'clock to about 4 or 5, we do the cooking for our Wednesday night and Sunday feedings. And I invite anybody who loves to cook to come into the Sanctuary Church at 1400 North Federal Highway. It's where we cook. We'd love to have you join us and help us prepare some of the homeless favorite dishes and perhaps some of yours. And I'll be very happy to answer any questions anybody may have. Okay, we'll do that afterwards. All right, well, thank you so much. This is a beautiful... This is a beautiful church, and I'm very happy to share my Sabbath with your Sabbath. Thank you.
Let the church say praise the Lord again. May the Lord continue to bless us as we worship him in spirit and in truth.
I just want to extend an open invitation to Mr. Abba to come again. To all modern day Jews and others, please stand for the call to worship. These words were beautifully penned by Moses. Let these words be yours today. On the screens and in the bulletin, we will read responsively. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Know ye that he is the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Altogether, for the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth for all generations. The church is now called to worship.
Thank you.
heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Father in heaven, we thank you again for the total sufficiency of Jesus Christ. We thank you, God, for allowing us to make it into this sacred space and sacred place one more time to worship and praise your holy name. Accept our worship as pleasing in your sight, that we may be drawn closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's repeat Isaiah 58, verses 13 and 14 together. If thou turn away...
Good morning, church. We'll be doing a different form of children's story, and Brother Bent will now take the mic.
Want you guys to cooperate with us. The children have been coming here Sabbath after Sabbath and been sitting down. So we would like them all to have a different way of story this morning. Okay, boys and girls. Good morning. Good morning, boys and girls. Okay, can we all stand? Can we all stand? Let's go. Let's stand. Let's get on feet. Let's go. Okay, guys. Okay. Come with me. All of you guys, come with me. Come follow me. Come follow me. Okay, let's go. Parents, just be with us a couple minutes extra this morning, okay? All right, let's go. All right. Okay. Now we're going to sing the song, Round the Walls of Jericho. And when we're all ready to go, this section here is the wall. And I'm going to ask everybody to stand. And when all the children watch around here, we all know how many times to go. As I said, bear with us for a couple extra minutes. Brittany, where's the mic? Okay. All right, Brittany going to lead out with a song as we go. Round the walls of Jericho, round the walls of Jericho. Army went round the walls of Jericho, round the walls of Okay, guys, thank you very much. Now what I want you to... Okay, guys, what I want you guys to do now...
We are blessed to have sharing with us the Ministry of Music, the group Testimony, and they will come and share at this time. They will also share later on in our worship. We welcome now to the stage Testimony at this time.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. Happy Sabbath, Lighthouse. Are you all kids under construction? Well, if you don't want to admit to it, I'll admit to it. I'm a kid under construction because God is not finished with me yet. What do you say?
Amen.
So the truth is we're all kids under construction because God is not finished with us yet. Amen?
Mic one.
Jesus died on the tree for me, and I'm gonna live forever. I'm gonna live forever. I'm gonna die, no, never. Jesus died on the tree for me, and I'm gonna live forever.
I know my name will never be hung in life upon a marquee, because Jesus Christ hung on a tree. I'm gonna live forever. King of the Jews, the cross proclaimed, while those around him mocked his name. It was for me that he bore all the shame, so I can live forever.
I'm gonna live forever. I'm gonna die, no, never. Jesus died on the tree for me, and I'm gonna live forever.
I know my name will never be written down in history, 'cause Jesus put my name in the book of life, and that's enough for me. Someday he's coming back again. Nothing for me will be the same. I'll have a new body and a brand new name. I'm gonna live forever.
I'm gonna live forever. I'm gonna die, no, never. Jesus died on the tree for me. I'm gonna live forever. I'm gonna live forever.
Yeah.
I'm gonna die, no, never.
No.
Jesus died on the tree for me, and I'm gonna live forever. Jesus died on the tree for me.
Listen to them sing forever. I can't wait to get there so I can sound like that. When I get to heaven, I'm going to sound like all the parts. Amen, amen. I look forward to that. There was a young man hanging out with his father who has, you know, just become to knowledge what money is. And him and his father was hanging out, and they were going places, you know, and they would go into the restaurant, and they would order things, and it would be the menu, the bill would come, and it'd be a high bill, 40, 50, 60 bucks. And the son would be like, "Dad, that's kind of a lot." He said, "Son, I love steak, so it don't matter." So they go around, he took his son to a ball game, and, you know, they buying all the pennants and the hats and things. You know, you buy a ball game hat. A regular hat is $2 or $3 in the day, but when you go to a game and it has somebody's name on it, the hat suddenly becomes $50 and $60. So he buys him and his son both a hat. "Son, I just love this team." Next day they get up, and they come to church. Father digs in his pocket, pulls out and put a dollar in the offering plate. May the deacons come forward. Let us pray. Father Heaven, we thank you for this opportunity to give unto thee a portion of what you have given unto us. A bless the gifts and the givers and those who have not to give. In Jesus' worthy name we do pray. Amen.
scripture reading for today is taken from Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in the green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yet though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anoint my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
This is our belief that the Lord in Zion reigneth. Hymn number 7. Let us join voices together as we sing joyfully. Hymn number 7.
Song. There is strength in the name of the Lord. There is power in the name of the Lord. There's hope in the name of the Lord. Thank God it didn't stop there. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. In other words, church, blessed are those who come in the name of the Lord. And it's prayer time, and usually we come a little closer, as it were, to the altar so that we can touch the hem of Christ's garment. So feel free to come now as we make our petitions known to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Gracious God of heaven, you have come to speak today, and we have come to listen. We pray, O God, that thou wilt give us attentive hearts and minds as we come. O God, we reflect on your goodness and your mercy. You woke us up this morning, brought us here safely to praise and to honor and to adore your holy name. Please accept our gratitude and our thanks, we pray. O God, we look around us, national and international scenes. And O God, the indication is even more riveted in our minds now that you're about to come. O God, the chaos that exists in our communities. We see the elderly being abused in the street, robbed and killed. We see transitioning taking place between countries and people fleeing their homeland. Oh God, the question comes to mind, how long? And sometimes we seem to get the answer, not long. So we pray, oh God, that you will continue to be in this world and to protect us. We see Christians being persecuted today. The time is near. So help us, oh God, to be ready to meet you when you come. Help us not to get discouraged. And whenever there is discouragement, grant us courage. Help us to be faithful amidst the chaos and the distractions. Oh God, we know the role that Satan plays. His role is to interrupt things, to create dissatisfaction. But we know that you're in control. So God, we pray that thou wouldst continue to be with us. We pray for those who have come a little closer to the altar this morning. You know the needs more than we do. So please attend to the needs of all of us as we wait upon you today. We pray for our pastor, Pastor Brissett, and his family. We know, God, that we're about to lose him. He's transitioning to another part of the vineyard. Oh God, please continue to take care of his affairs as they think about relocating. Oh God, we pray that thou wilt continue to be with us here at the Lighthouse Seventh-day Adventist Church. Oh God, we need you. Continue to take care of the affairs of this church. The financial affairs, the spiritual affairs, the sociological affairs of our church. Continue to bless us. You're a good God, compassionate God. You're in control. You died on the cross of Calvary to save us. You have been redeemed. We have been redeemed by your shed blood. We are your children. So we pray that thou wilt continue to lead us aright. Oh God, this is a special day in our church, Community Guest Day. We see the injustices all over, the homeless, the poor, and those who need your attention. Come close, O God, to provide the resources that's needed, even in our church, our community center here. Provide for us. And then, oh God, we pray a special prayer today for the young people of this church. We pray a special prayer for our youth class. Oh God, the be with their curious minds and their inquisitive minds and, oh God, please take care of them and guide and direct their footsteps. Be with the environment in which they traverse every day, at school, public transportation, the things that are taking place, even in their high schools. Be with them. Continue to enlighten and to instruct them. Illuminate their minds, oh God, so that they might see the things that you teach them. We pray for every man, every woman, every boy, every girl who have come today to gain a blessing. Please accept our worship today. Accept us. Hear us. We pray in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Time for the spoken words. What a blessing it has been thus far. Today we are here because God has invited us to come, so we are here to give him all the praise and honor. We know that there is a message that the Lord has sent for us today. And so while you sit, you listen, just pray a prayer in your heart that the Lord will speak to none other but you through the spoken words from the pastor. Just before Pastor Brissett comes to us to sing this morning, we know the testimonies from those who testify in their songs will come again. Let us also listen to that message in their song, because I am confident that there is even one line in that song will be for every single one of us sitting here today. So listen to those words. After they sing, then the next voice will be here, will be none other than the pastor, Pastor Brissett. Hear he this morning the words of our Heavenly Father.
just want to say by extension that we're happy to be here in your congregation. But we just want to say thanks for the participation of the persons who were involved in the hurdle event last week, Sabbath afternoon at Lauderhill. We were blessed to have you there, and we hope that we'll continue this good relationship between us both. Amen.
Send the gleam across the way. You may rest, you may send up the night of cedar fill.
Trim your feeble lamp, my brother. Some poor sailors
as well.
Thank you, Testimony, for your ministry of music.
and peace like a river attendeth my way. When sorrows like sea billows my soul, it is well with my soul.
Let's sing, it is well. It is well. No music. It is well with my soul. One more time, it is well. It is well with my soul. Pour into us today a word that will inspire and encourage us, that will keep us steadfast during these turbulent days of Earth's history. In Jesus' name we pray. For the next few moments, I want to approach from the subject. Sometimes the devil gets in the sound too. Let's try this again. For the next few moments, I want to just, let's just use the cordless mic. Amen. Amen. I want to just preach from the subject. He is the great shepherd. He is the great shepherd. This week, my attention was arrested by the news, unfortunate tragedy of hearing about a 31-year-old drummer whose car broke down on an off-ramp on 95, and while waiting for help was approached by a police officer out of uniform in an unmarked car, who in approaching Corey Jones felt as if his life was in danger. And as Corey Jones ran from the man who he did not yet know was a police officer, 5 shots were fired at 2 separate occasions, resulting in the death of a 31-year-old drummer who was just waiting for help to get his car started and going again. as I spent time on Thursday watching the rally in Palm Beach County. I watched as the father of Corey Jones stepped to the microphone, broken at the loss of his son. I watched as this pastor, whose eyes were welled with tears, shared with thousands of people that on today he would bury his mother, and later on this week he'll bury his son. And I thought about what that family must be going through, not even that, but the wider circle of friends, even some of our own young people in our churches in Palm Beach County who knew him because he played for churches. Had the opportunity to hear from a friend last night who said the last time she saw him, he played at their church there in Delray. And when she approached him after worship to give him the gratuity for his services, he would not take it because his joy was in being able to use the gift God gave him and not what he could get from it. Having been at worship experiences and preached, and having seen him on the drums, knowing others who know him well, and hearing the great testimony of Corey Jones' life. And as I watched his father, with tears in his eyes, try to encourage and rally a community for justice, my knees and my heart bent toward the sacred scriptures of the Bible, because I needed to hear from the Lord what could encourage a community when it is clear that human life is not valued. As I paused for reflection, the Lord took my attention to a familiar passage of scripture, probably next to John 3:16, probably one of the most well-known scriptures in all of the Bible. To give you context to content, the backdrop of Psalm 23 allows us to get a glimpse of David pausing for reflection as he looks over his life. Many scholars suggest that one of the scenes that passes through David's mind is that of the moment where he was being chased by Saul and hunted by Absalom. And David's life and journey has come to a place where he takes time to reflect over his youth, the moments where the Lord had used him to subdue and slay a lion and a bear and a giant. He looks back at his life, how he has seen the hand of the Lord, how he's been tried and tested. And with all of the experiences that he has, with all of the experiences that David is able to tell, with all the royalty that he has attained, his sole declaration is not in what he has accomplished. His opening line of this well-loved psalm is simply a declaration, "The Lord is my shepherd." Now, I don't want you to miss what's happening here, because David is making a private and personal declaration. He is making it known that the Lord is not one of many. He's making it known that he is God all by himself. I need you to remember today, in the midst of a world that we're living in, that there is none besides the Lord our God. He shares space with no one. There's no one above him. There's no one beside him. There's none that can compare to him. God alone has the qualifications to be able to be high and lifted up. And David does not want to leave any room for doubt. And I need the church to remember that you can travel far and wide, look here and there, search every nook and cranny, investigate every possibility, yet you will find none like Jehovah. And David was absolutely, confidently, and justifiably most accurate when he penned the words, "The Lord." David is talking about Jehovah Roy, the Lord as shepherd, who has been with him all the days of his life. And even though David had kept sheep, and even though it was popular to to have shepherds in the Eastern Mediterranean and the regions of Mesopotamia, even though there were a lot of good shepherds. David can accurately defend his position that yes, there are many good shepherds, but there's only one great shepherd. And as we reflect today, I want to encourage you, Lighthouse, that no matter what you are feeling, no matter what your position is on what you have been observing in the news, what you have been witnessing around your communities, embrace this personal affirmation of David and make it your own. Today, you ought to, if nothing else, come to the conclusion that the Lord is your shepherd. Now, don't miss this, because too many of us are trying to have a relationship with God through somebody else's relationship, but you cannot have a relationship with God that is not your own. You can't have it by osmosis. You can't have it by transition. You can't have it by transfer. You've got to have your own relationship with God that you can draw upon. So when life has its challenges, when life has its hurdles, when life gives you ups and downs, when life pours you sour lemons, you can confidently declare, "It is well with my soul, and the Lord is my shepherd, because the great shepherd gives me everything that I need to survive on this planet called Earth." David has seen the Lord move in mighty ways. He was with him with the lion and the bear. He was with him as he faced Goliath. He was with him as he ran from Saul from cave to cave. He was with him when he ran from Absalom. He was with him when he faced enemies. David knows all too well what it's like to be in the great care of a great shepherd. And that ought to be the testimony of about 125 of you in here today. You can say, like the songwriter, Through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to lean and depend on Him. If I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that God would solve them. And I've come to share with the church. I feel like preaching a little bit. I don't care how good you are of a caretaker. I don't care how good your family takes care of you. I don't care how good your boss is to you. There's nobody that can manage you and take care of you like the great shepherd. So David says, the Lord is not just yours, the Lord is my, I know Him. Says, the Lord is my shepherd. And I want us to be some very honest and transparent on this afternoon, because we need the Lord. Because as sheep, we cannot survive on our own. You see, sheep by nature are not the brightest animals. They require safety. They require nurturing. They require being taken care of. They require attention. The sheep have no means of defense, and even though they flock together, their numbers do not increase their strength nor intellect. Their only safety lies in the power and the carefulness of the shepherd. The Middle Eastern shepherd loved his sheep, gave each one of them a name, and cared for each one tenderly. And many a shepherd interposed himself between wild beasts and his sheep. And at night, the shepherd lay down and slept in the single doorway to his sheepfold, because any enemy would have to pass him to first attack his sheep. I'm just going to leave you today with understanding that the first reason why the Lord is the great shepherd is because He gives to us as His sheep the satisfaction of provision. I promise you, I'm in the scripture. Listen to what the Word of God says. The Lord is my shepherd, Psalm 23, verse 1. I shall not want. Now, let's be honest. People want a lot of things. People want money. People want power. People want respect. People want wives. People want husbands. Children want toys. People want a lot of things. But a sheep, don't miss it today, a sheep doesn't want for anything when the sheep is in the care of the great shepherd. The great shepherd knows how to meet all the needs of the sheep. Now, the text says that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In other words, when I have the great shepherd looking after me, that's all I need. See, y'all done went to sleep already. Y'all done been here all day. Y'all done went to sleep. Y'all didn't catch that. I really could have said the appeal right after that. The Lord is my shepherd. I don't need anything else. And then the text goes on to say, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. So we not only see Jehovah Rahi, Jehovah Raha, but is here we also see Jehovah Jireh. Okay. The great shepherd offers to his sheep relaxation. Let the church say relaxation. Green pastures. This is a symbol, church, of spiritual nourishment. As long as we are following the leading of the shepherd, we will always be fed by the shepherd. Because the shepherd knows how to take care of the sheep. Inventors know how to take care of their inventions. The creator knows how to provide for his creation. And a good shepherd, I'm talking about somebody who's doing the bare minimum, Elder Lindsay. A good shepherd never lets his sheep starve. He sees to it that they are fed regularly throughout the day because his livelihood is dependent on the health of the sheep. And so while the shepherd is trying to lead you and I as sheep to green pastures where we can be fed a proper spiritual diet, I want to caution us today because many sheep want to graze in grass that is more brown than it is green. You see, brown grass is grass that is burnt. It's withered, dead, or about to die. You see, brown grass, when we look at brown grass, it is clear that the grass has not been properly taken care of. The grass is of no use to man or animal. Let me be clear, saints. Brown grass is not good for your health. Okay, y'all ain't there. The fields of unrighteousness are covered with brown grass. And there are too many sheep living up to their nature, straying from the pasture that provides the best nourishment and trying to get healthy in grass that provides no comfort or health. I want to suggest to you today that the shepherd wants you and I to make peace and lie relaxed in green pastures. Because green pastures are not just good for eating, they're good for resting. Okay, I gotta apply that because y'all didn't catch that. Green pastures are not just good for eating, they're good for relaxing. Okay, y'all still missed it. Not only will the Lord lead you to the word to be fed, but he'll allow the word to resonate and live in your heart so you can live in peace. I know people are looking for peace in a lot of different areas. You're confusing the difference between peace and happiness and joy. I know that's being confused in contemporary society. But what David is teaching us through the text is that he's able to live a life of peace, joy, and happiness because his entire sustenance, his entire livelihood rests in the hands of the one who's never lost a patient. The one who's never lost a case. The one who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. The one who David wrote about in Psalm 8. He says, when I consider the heavens and the works that thou hast made, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou art have visited him? When you turn over to Psalms 24, David will further declare, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. That's why he could write Psalm 23 with a degree of confidence, because he has seen the Lord.
take care of his needs. Bring him to a place of rest. And if you want to have a degree of peace in your life in 2015, if you want to have a degree of peace in your life amidst all the hell that you have to deal with, you need to get it in your heart that the Lord is your shepherd, and if he's watching over you, you have everything that you need. Somebody say amen. In the place, not only, watch this, not only does he lead you, not only does he make you to lie down in green pastures, that's the relaxation, but he leadeth beside still waters. Now to get the understanding of this, by nature, sheep are frantic and frazzled animals. If you watch them, They are known as the can't get right crew. You watch sheep and you'll catch it real quick. But they, you know, they're a little off. They assimilate their behavior to their environment. They react similar to whatever's going on around them. So if they are in an area where there is commotion, they will cause commotion amongst themselves as well. However, the church say, however, the great shepherd knows that if they are in a calm environment, then they themselves will act in a calm manner. I just said a mouthful. Let me go ahead and make it live. Aren't you glad that the Lord has taken you out of some of the chaotic environments you used to be in? Because he knows if he left you in the chaotic environment, you would do everything but right. Come on, don't fool me today, Lighthouse. Don't fool me. Somebody in here ought to be grateful that you're not where you used to be. That the Lord snatched you out of some chaotic environments, pulled you out of some dysfunctional relationships, took you away from some jobs that were chaotic, took you away from some neighborhoods, and the Lord knows where he needs to put you so that you can do what he needs you to do. And sheep are chaotic. Listen, and then there are some of you who act the way your environment acts because you don't know any better. You don't know who you are, so you act like the environment around you. Can't say amen, say ouch. You know you grew up in the church, but you tried the club out, and so you went to the club, and while the music was playing, you just looked bad. Okay, yeah, I don't know nothing. Okay. You knew that you weren't supposed to smoke cigarettes, but you got around a bunch of people, so in order to fit in, you smoked the cigarette, and you don't even look right puffing on the cigarette. Come on, tell the truth, shame the devil. You know that you have no business drinking liquor, and yet you get around some people who drink it, and because you want to be accepted, you order scotch and martini, you order it dry with no ice, and you sip it and you throw it up because you're not supposed to drink. You don't even know the bar lingo. You go. You don't know the club demeanor, behavior. Listen, but Jesus, the great shepherd, knows what we need. And he pulls us out of chaotic environments. Listen, as a matter of fact, it's not in my notes, but thank you, Holy Spirit. Some of you ought to get your pen and paper out right now and start writing a thank you letter to the chaotic environments that the Lord pulled you out of. Thank him for the relationships he pulled you out of. Thank God that he didn't allow you to marry the knucklehead you were about to marry. Okay, all right. This is a tough sermon today. I thought it was going to be easier than this. Thank God that he doesn't allow sheep to stay unled. He says, so sheep, they assimilate to their environment. So in order to keep the sheep calm, so they can be nourished, so they can get cleansing, the shepherd, don't miss this, they're now by still waters. The shepherd, in order to keep them calm, in order so that they can get nourishment and refreshing, the shepherd creates a dam in order that the stream of water will flow in a calm and soothing manner, and this will keep the sheep calm so that they can drink in peace and get refreshed. Let me pause here to tell somebody that we ought to be glad that the great shepherd knows how to turn rough waters into still waters. so that you can get the spiritual refreshing that you need. Everybody in here today ought to be shouting, thank you, Jesus, that the great shepherd knows how to keep the waters in your life calm on your behalf. He kept bill collectors from snatching your stuff. He kept you alive even though you've been told you were sick. He gave you a day of rest so that the trials of the week wouldn't drive you insane. Because the great shepherd knows that sometimes you can't handle rough waters. He knows that if things are too haywire in your external reality, you'll go crazy. So he creates still waters for you to be able to have refreshing and repose. But not only does he provide still waters for spiritual refreshing, but he restores your soul. In other words, I don't have a lot of time. In other words, he makes your life whole again. That's all restores my soul means. He makes your life whole again. Now, we already learned that sheep are not the smartest animals on the planet. They are prone to things that make us scratch our heads in curiosity and bewilderment. But then again, we do the same to God. We do things that makes God scratch his head and look at us, and all he can say sometimes is, again? You right back there again. Didn't I just pull you out of that? And here you go again? That's why the writer writes, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have followed after our own. But one of the things that happens to sheep every now and again is that in the middle of their sojourn, somebody's sleeping, you need to wake them up right now. Don't miss this. One of the things that happens to sheep every now and again is that they fall on their backs with their legs straight up in the air, rendering them upside down and completely helpless. Yeah, they are so uncoordinated and so prone to making blunders and mistakes by nature that every now and again, when things get too chaotic, when they get too busy and they go beyond what they really are capable of, they end up on their backs with their feet in the air, rendering them helpless. And for animals that are not that bright to begin with, this is a problem. Now you're probably laughing and wondering what's so significant about that. Well, the fact that they fall on their backs with their legs up in the air is not the puzzling part, but it is that they don't know how to get back on their feet once in that position. In order for them to get back on their feet, God, I feel like shouting out of my shoes. An observant shepherd, a great shepherd, has to pick them up and turn them right side up. Okay, y'all ain't even. Let me drive this home. As sheep, we are not as bright as we think we are. Sometimes we fall on our backs in life with our legs up in the air and we'll be upside down, rendering ourselves helpless. Sometimes we get ourselves into relationships that turn us upside down, activities and habits that turn us upside down, and it takes the great shepherd to forgive us, pick us up, turn us right side up, and not only impart happiness so that the soul is fit for holier service and more extensive use, but the shepherd picks up the sheep and dust off the residue of having fallen on their back. Okay, when I was growing up in school, God help me today, I didn't want to preach this hard, but I feel my help coming on. When I was in school, after school, there was something that we all had to take part in. We had to take part in erasing the board. And so what would happen is one student, Elder Davis, he would go get the bucket of water for the sponge, and then another student would erase the blackboard. The student who erased the blackboard, after he's done erasing the blackboard, is followed by the student who has the sponge and the soap and water. And the student with the sponge and the soap and water will take the sponge, soap and water, and apply it to where the eraser had erased. Now, don't miss this, because the eraser is not infallible, so the eraser leaves a residue of what was on the board. But when the student comes behind with the sponge and the water, and they put the sponge and the water over the board, it takes away the residue from what was on. Okay, y'all, come here. I'm so glad that the Lord doesn't allow the fragments of human fallibility to stay on the boards of our lives, but rather on a hill called Calvary, the blood of Jesus erased the residue. And so when we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thank God that the residue of our life is not still posted on the blackboard of our reality. And in that moment, don't miss this, in that moment where the stain or the residue is taken away, we are justified. The board, when it is clear of all of the chalk, is made new. When the blood of Jesus comes into our life and cleanses our hearts, we are made new. We are put in right standing with God. But God knows that on our own, we will not get right. Come on, talk to me today. He knows on our own, we will not get right. He knows on our own that we will take our time coming to him, because a lot of us think we only live once, so I'm going to live and do everything I can to the fullest. I'm going to partake in whatever activity I can. I'm going to do whatever I can, go wherever I can, be with whoever I'm going to be with, do whatever I want to do. I only get one chance to live, and we continue to fall on our backs helpless. But then the great shepherd doesn't just have us as his flock. He's in it with us. And he will not allow us to stay on our backs dirty when he knows how to keep us clean. So here is what I understand, is that we today, in these turbulent times, in times we fall on our backs, let's always be grateful to God that he doesn't leave us on our back without hope. He doesn't forget about you and I. He doesn't charge us and keep us connected to the foolishness we did. He restores our soul. He gives us new life. When the soul grows sorrowful, he revives it. When it's sinful, he sanctifies it. When it's weak, he strengthens it. When it wanders, he brings it back. God knows how to keep his sheep healthy. In the book entitled "The Forgiving God in an Unforgiving World," a true story is told. A priest in the Philippines, a much-loved man of God who carried the burden of a secret sin he had committed many years before. He had repented, but still had no peace, no sense of God's forgiveness. In his parish was a woman who deeply loved God and who claimed to have visions in which she spoke with Christ and he with her. The priest, however, was skeptical. To test her, he said, "The next time you speak with Christ, I want you to ask what sin your priest committed while he was in the seminary." The woman agreed, and a few days later, the priest asked, "Well, did Christ visit you in your dreams?" She answered, "Yes, he did." The priest said, "And did you ask him what sin I committed in the seminary?" The woman looked at him and said, "Yes." The priest looked at her and said, "Well, what did he say?" The woman answered and said to the priest, "Christ said, I don't remember." Yeah. 12:58. I'm going to go ahead and bring this to y'all. Y'all ain't there. Let me say it one more time. He asked her, "What did Christ say when you asked him about what sin I committed in seminary?" She answered, he responded, "I don't remember." Okay. Y'all still didn't get that one. I'm gonna say it one more time for the people who, you know, you got that 1 o'clock itch resting over your spirit. He said, "Did Christ visit you in your dreams?" She said, "Yes." "Did you ask him what sin I committed in the seminary?" She said, "Yes." He said, "What did he say?" "He said, I don't remember." Can you thank God that Christ doesn't hold against you what you did to him? Listen, this is a reason why we can't ever think of ourselves highly than we really are. Because as sheep, we have fallen on our backs, gotten dirty by the sin and the righteousness of life, But the shepherd didn't leave us there to remain helpless. He brought hope in the midst of hopelessness. He brought a cleansing to a dirty flock. Anybody glad you've been cleaned by the blood of Jesus? Anybody glad today that it reaches to the highest mountain and it flows to the lowest valley? The blood that gives you strength from day to day, it'll never lose its power. Do I have some people in Lighthouse today glad that the Lord didn't leave you on the outskirts of the flock, dirty with your legs up in the air? But Jesus came and he saw about you. The old folk used to say, he picks me up and he turns me around and he places my feet on solid ground. Yeah. He restores my soul. Not only that, he leadeth me in the paths of righteousness. One writer said, life is not a fold to lie down in. It's a road for them to walk on. It's important to remember that sheep follow and shepherds lead. Sheep are unqualified to lead the shepherd because sheep, by nature, don't know better. I don't need 30 seconds, maybe even less, to unpack this. Your life will be sweeter when you follow and let God lead. Okay, yeah, I'm really done with that point. I really don't have to go any further. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness. The shepherd won't lead the sheep into danger. Oh, gosh. I don't even have time, but I'm going to take it. Because the stuff that God has for us, many times we think it's unreasonable, and so we mock and we laugh at righteous instruction. We don't want to be led, we want to lead. I don't care how great your GPA is. I don't care how many certificates and recognitions you've received. You are not omniscient. You are not omnipotent. And if the Creator knows how to dust off the residue of the creation, then he also knows how to lead you in the right path. Your life will be sweeter when you follow and let God lead. Okay, here it is, here it is. Whatever you're praying about, stop telling God to follow your lead and submit yourself to God's leading. I'm gonna leave that right there. Okay, so watch this. The only way that the sheep will be on the right path is if they follow the shepherd. The shepherd goes ahead of the sheep and makes sure that the pathway ahead is clear of anything that may pose a problem. A great shepherd, let the church say great shepherd, such as the great shepherd in our text, will never take sheep along a path that isn't right for their safe passage. And so not only does he give provision, but he also gives protection. Let the church say protection. Now watch this, the great shepherd is not only making provision, he's making protection. David's comments suggest further satisfaction with the management skills of his God, because from verses 2 and 3, David has given us a clear picture of how he has been taken care of. The common subject in verses 2 and 3 of Psalm 23 is he, meaning God, has taken care of his every need. And so because of God's faithfulness to David, verse 4 is the transitional verse where David can confidently declare that because of all that God has done to keep him thus far, when he goes through the valley of the shadow of death, he is not scared. Okay, watch this. So having spent some time in the mountains enjoying relaxation, restoration, and reconciliation, the sheep are on the way from the mountains back to the sheepfold. On their way home, they have to pass through some valleys, because this is the terrain of the Middle East. I want to let somebody know that life is not always lived in the mountains, but there are times when you will have to spend a little time in the valley. You know the rule of physics, what goes up must come down. What goes around comes around. And valleys are often dangerous places because of the conditions that are not easily observed. In other words, the plush lands, the beautiful flowers, the scenery of the mountains often provide a false sense of security. The buildings around us and the homes being built and the luxury we see around us, it provides a false sense of security because in the shadows of the valley are wild animals that seek to destroy sheep who are known to be helpless and weak. So in these rocks and caves, where these dangerous predators live, we have wolves, mountain lions, coyotes, jackals, these vicious animals that hang out in the rocky terrain just waiting for an opportunity to devour the sheep. Now, under the care of a lazy shepherd, sheep are easily slaughtered and butchered. The valley can easily become a grave site. It can easily become the valley of death. And sometimes we go through certain trials and tribulations and observe certain things around us that make us feel like we're about to die. We feel restless, helpless, hopeless, friendless, and joyless. It feels like someone stuck their hands in your chest, got a hold of your heart, and ripped it out. However, watch the text, because David does not say it is a valley of death. He says it is the valley of the close attention. In other words, it's not death. It's the shadow. It's not real. It has no power. It has no ability. It has no strength. It's just a shadow. We know those who have come to the place of maturity that shadows are not real. They have no substance because shadows are nothing more than obstructions and manipulations of light. In order for a shadow to exist, light must be present, so that if you focus on the light, you come to realize that a shadow is just what you get when light is surrounded by a little darkness. Stay with me. Now, as threatening as darkness might be, a little light always makes darkness not seem as bad as it appears. You got to see this. You got to see this thing. David says that the valley, a depression in between two mountain slopes, can sometimes be a place where shadows are dark, but that's all they are, just shadows. He says that they may have power to hinder, but they possess no power to hold. So that's why he says, I can walk through the valley. It may feel like the end, but it's just a shadow. It may feel like the grand finale, or that it will go on forever. It may feel like total devastation. It may feel like you're trapped with your back against the wall. But saints of God, the valley of our external reality is just a shadow. And even though I walk through the shadow, tell somebody next to you real quick, it's just a shadow. So you missed it. So watch this. David said, yea, though I walk through the valley. He did not say to. Don't miss this. He says, yea, though I walk through. He did not say to. Okay, I'm going to say it again. David says, yea, though I walk through. He didn't say, yea, though I walk to. Okay, all right, one more time, because you're still not catching it. Yea, though I walk through. Talk to this side. David says, yea, though I walk through. In other words, when I get to the valley, oh, God help me today. When I get to the valley, I'm not going to stop in the valley. I'm going to come out the other side of the valley. This is a prophetic declaration, because he knows that he's not walking through the valley by himself. He's walking through the valley, because the same shepherd that led him to the valley is the same shepherd that's going to lead him through the valley. He says, I don't have to fear any evil because the shepherd is with me. Where can I go from the presence of the Lord? If I make my bed in the depths of hell, behold, he is there. If I ascend to the uttermost part of the heavens, behold, he is there. When I was a kid, they used to sing a song, A.Y., he's all over me, and he's keeping me alive. I feel him in my hands. God help me today. I feel him in my feet. There's a certain boldness that this kind of sheep possesses, a calm demeanor, a tranquility, so that even in the most terrible circumstances, they refuse to become agitated because the shepherd is with. Now, he walks through the valley of the shadow of death. I'm going to close it out. So he gets provision. He gets protection. But finally, sheep, when they're in the care of the great shepherd, experience promotion. Can I get 5 minutes? I didn't get enough 5 minutes. Can I get 5 minutes? I ain't get enough. Can I get 5 minutes? Okay, I saw about four hands in the back. Another 20 minutes. I'm going to just take 5 of the 20, 1/4. Okay. Watch the text. He says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. So the rod for protection, the staff for correction, okay? Don't miss this. The rod for protection to keep away the animals, and then the staff to bring the sheep back into the fold. Somebody today ought to be thanking God as loud as you can that just when the wild beast tried to take you out, the shepherd's rod beat the beast off of you. And then stuck out the staff to bring you back to the fold. Watch this, verse 5. Thou preparest the promotion. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Now, the literal translation of thou preparest a table before me in the presence of, the literal translation, the Masoretic translation of the text, means to the mortification of my oppressors. In other words, what David is saying, the Lord takes care of him so that when the Lord brings him to the king's table, his enemies have to sit there and watch him eat what the king has prepared. Okay. But don't miss this. In order to eat at the table, you have to have enemies. No enemies? No table. This is a Twitterific moment. A prerequisite for promotion is tribulation. You need the valley to get to the table. And thou preparest the table so that the sheep get to eat in front of the people who try to do them harm. And the people who tried to do them harm have to watch as the sheep eat. Now, I got to paint a picture because some of y'all missed that. Anything about kings and royalty, just this past week, Queen Elizabeth had this great feast and had a lot of guests there. And there was a lot of, pomp and circumstance. And they had to watch the Queen Elizabeth that whenever she stopped eating, they had to stop eating. And it was all prompted by the movements of the queen. But any royal, listen, not even at a king's palace. If you go to Sterling Hall and eat with us, it is not a mediocre meal. Royalty prepares feasts. And so the sheep get to eat seven-course meal while enemies have to sit there and watch. Okay, y'all missed it. Enemies are subdued by the power of God because God is more concerned in taking care of his sheep than he is pleasing his enemies. And one day, when judgment is done away with, there will be a group of sheep who will sit at the banquet table, and those who hear depart from me have to sit and watch the sheep who are faithful eat at the table. Now, this messes with some folk because there are certain theologians who are trying to figure out where David is headed. Is David talking about the future when he'll be in heaven? Well, what was David talking about? So there's a little confusion surrounding it. But the true hermeneutic and exegetical stance of the text shows us that what David, more than anything else, is looking forward to is when he spends eternity in the presence of the Lord. He's living, watch this, he's living in his current situation with the expectation that if he trusts the great shepherd will lead him to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Yeah, there's more, but I'm done. Don't miss this. In this life, make sure that you live trusting the shepherd so that he can lead you to the place where you spend time with him forever. Resist the temptation to stray from the flock and to stray from the fold. Because sheep don't know how to take care of sheep. Only a great shepherd knows how to take care of sheep. There's only one great shepherd. His name. I know we all are going to face similar circumstances when we walk out that door this afternoon. But I beg of you, let the shepherd lead you, and he'll take you to safe places. Who believes God's word today? Jones family were here, I would tell them, be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. I'm so glad I have a shepherd who's a guide and a guard. So glad I have a shepherd who knows that a long journey can make me hungry. And so along the journey, he makes sure that I have the nourishment I need to sustain me for the journey. So glad I have a shepherd who, when I fall on my back, doesn't leave me alone. Friends and family will walk away from you, but the great shepherd returns to where you fell, picks you up, cleans you off, and brings you back the fold to continue the journey. I'm so glad I have a shepherd who knows better than me what I need. And today, somebody needs to give their whole life over to the direction of the great shepherd. You I need to be honest with God and admit that on our own, we've just been making a mess of life. But if we let the great shepherd guide us and lead us, then we have the hope, the expectation, and the realization that God will see us through. I'm going to share the brief testimony I was sharing with somebody yesterday. I think I even shared this morning. The unbelievable weight that my wife and I had been experiencing with our fathers over the last couple of months. Moments where we didn't know what was going to happen and trying to make sure affairs were in order and dealing with legal issues and so forth and so on and having to travel back and forth. And this week, as a result of prayer and supplication and fasting and trying to just give God the entire situation, we would just say, Lord, you got to do it. We cannot take care of it. You got to do it. God, heal. God, make whole. God, do what you have to do. This week, every day that I talked to my mother, she says, my father had a better day. My father-in-law went to the doctor, and he had healed to the point where they were able to take the trach out, and she was able to talk to him without the assistance of the trach. When you allow God to lead, you'll come to the valley, but you're going to come out if you let him lead you. And for the first time in weeks, I was able to sleep through the entire night without waking up, because he leadeth me beside still waters and he restoreth my soul. I learned. God was telling me that as long as you keep trying to leave the flock, you're going to fall on your back. But when you give it over to me, I'm going to help you exit the valley of the shadow of death. And today, I'm not just the only one in here who can testify that the Lord has brought you through some valleys. You can say, like the song says, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me that I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Today, somebody needs to get under the guidance of the great shepherd. Where are you today? It may be for a spiritual transformation. It may be for something else going on in your life that you need the great shepherd. You're giving over everything to him. One is coming. Come on. You need the great shepherd to lead you and you follow, because you understand today that's the only way that they're really going to have peace in your life. Come on to the altar. Come on. You know it's you. You need to give it over. You need to follow. The great shepherd needs to lead, no matter how big or small it is. Come on. You need to let go and let God. Where are you? God bless you, my sister. Another's coming. Come on. We just want to pray for you today. There's an issue going on very shortly that you have been trying to handle on your own. You're not seeing any progress. And today God is saying, let me handle this. And you commit this. The Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. Come on. Hours late, we spent our time. We need the great shepherd to heal some of our church family. Sister Williamson came this morning and shared that her neighbor's husband is at the point of death. How many of you know, even when you're at the point of death, the great shepherd has the last say? Where are you? You need God to guide. Somebody in here needs God to guide your character and your tongue. It's not your feet that are leaving the flock. It's your mouth that leaves the flock. And you're saying today, God, please help me. Listen, please don't leave during the call to the invitation to discipleship, the call to come to the altar. Please respect the moment. There are people who are praying about their spiritual lives right now. Please respect the moment. Do not leave. We're going to close, but God is moving on some hearts. Ushers, I'm going to ask you to go to the door and keep the door closed. Let God lead and you follow. I shared it last week. I'm going to share it again. The highest praise to God is not hallelujah, it's obedience. And somebody today needs to confess to God that you need to be more obedient to him, letting him lead and you follow. Come on, come on. Where are you? God bless you, my sister. God bless you. Come on, where are you? Where are you? You've been trying to handle it on your own, and today the Lord is saying, cast your cares upon me. Let me guide you. Let me give you goodness and mercy to follow you. God bless you, my dear. God bless you. Where's somebody else? Heads are bowed. Eyes are closed. Eternal Father in heaven, we thank you for your word, for those who came, because they need the Lord to guide and direct. They need the Lord to lead. And God, we know there are many others who have the same prayer on their heart. God, I pray today that you would convict and convert all of us under the sound of your voice, with the understanding that our lives are the most secure in the care of a great shepherd. Oh God, today, you're calling for obedience across the body of Christ. We know, God, that injustice is running rampant throughout the streets of our communities. We know that violence is escalating in our schools. But what's going to keep us safe is not more armed officers. What's going to keep us safe is being in the hands of the great shepherd. We know that burglar alarms are not going to protect us, but the great shepherd is going to protect us. God, help us today, because when we walk out these doors, life is going to hit us. It's going to touch us in a very tangible way. We pray that the great shepherd will be our guard and our guide. Thank you for your word today. May it strengthen and keep us, is our prayer. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Let all God's children together say amen. Listen, hug the person next to you and tell them that the Lord is your great shepherd. Come on, hug them. Hug them. The Lord is your great shepherd. Lord is your great shepherd. Amen. Who says amen to the word of God today? We're going to invite Sister Young to give us our benediction and closing hymn. I'm going to ask Sister Young that during the benediction you would also bless the food so that we will be ready to partake. Visitors and friends, you are welcome to share with us physical food across the hall in Sterling Hall. We have enough for everybody, and we really would feel honored and blessed if you would stay by and take partake with us in that. Amen.
and how appropriate that we sing number 537, He Leadeth Me. He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O words with heavenly comfort fraught. What here I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. Still our troubled sea, still 'tis His hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. Shall we bow our heads now unto Him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before His throne of grace with exceeding joy. To the only wise God our Savior be glory and majesty both now and forever. Amen. Father, we thank You for the meal You have provided. We thank You for those who spent time to prepare it. We pray Your blessing upon it, dear Father, and upon our bodies as we partake of it. But Father, the greatest thing, may we all feast with You in paradise, for Christ's sake.